I'm Holly, and I am in one of my asset storage folders. This one specifically is Cylia Pick and Place. It contains 4,800 objects, not including individual parts, and this is a part of three folders that I use for storing my assets, which make up for over 9,000 assets overall. That's a lot of stuff. And a couple weeks ago, I wanted to make a video talking about how I store my assets, which sounds like the most boring thing on paper, but for some reason, 100,000 people watched it. Thank you very much for your support. And the number one question that was asked, other than can I have them, is how did you make them? And so I'm going to talk about it today. There's a lot of misconceptions about my assets and where they came from. Some people think that they are all free models. That's not true. Some people think that they are all stolen. That's not true. Some people think that I made every single one from scratch. That also, I'm sorry, is not true. But don't get me wrong, there are definitely things in here that I have made from scratch. All of these chairs right here, I made from scratch. These were made with parts, along with some of this foliage stuff over here, and some of these tables as well. But no, I'm sorry to burst your bubble, but only about maybe 15% of the stuff that you're seeing right now was made entirely from scratch by me. About 5% of the objects you're seeing here is Toolbox, and the remaining 80% of everything you're seeing right now is 3D scans. That's right, 3D scans. I'm gonna get into that in a bit and show you how exactly I turn 3D scans into assets that I can use for development. But before I do that, I want to quickly talk to you about workflow management. I talk about this in last week's video, but there is a huge misconception with free models on Roblox. People think that it's wrong and it's lazy and it's uncreative to use assets that are not yours, and that is not true. It is a completely standard industry practice to use royalty-free assets to save time. I am a showcase artist. I create hyper-realistic builds on Roblox that I make to challenge the Roblox engine and promote it, and quite simply, you would not be seeing anything from me within the next 3 years if I had made everything from scratch. And I'm not less of a developer for saving my precious time. If I zoom in on some of these objects, ignore the textureless ones over here, Roblox Studio's just having a funny day today. There are a few things that all of these assets have in common with each other. Number one being they all look quite old. They all look like the kinds of things you would find at an antique store. Another thing you might notice is that they have very strange textures. And another thing, they all have quite strange topography and could definitely be optimized further. However, I chose not to save time again. So what you're seeing right now are actually 3D scans of museum artifacts. All of these tools, museum artifacts. All of this furniture, even these plates. If you've ever played any of my games, you might have noticed that on the credits board of some of the more recent games, I actually include all of the museums whose objects have been used in this game. But these museums are all around the world. Virtual Museums of Malpolska is in Poland, Santa Cruz, Vienna, the Hunt Museum in Ireland. Did I really go to all of these museums all around the world just to scan 3D objects for my games? Yes! Just kidding, no. However, if you want to do that, you absolutely can, and I can tell you how. 3D scanning is the process of getting a camera and running it around a model. The camera will figure out a rough idea of the object that they're looking at, and then they will translate it into triangles, which you can then edit around in a 3D software like Blender. And you don't need a fancy 3D scanning camera to do that. You can install apps on your phone. I personally recommend MakerWorld AI Scanner. You can walk around an object with your camera to scan an object, and it's AI powered, and so it doesn't have to be 100% accurate. The AI can figure out what exactly it's looking at and help you. Another really interesting app that I learned about recently was Unyuan3D. It's a site that you can go to upload 2D images, and it will use AI to take a look at that image and then translate it into a 3D model for you. And it's super cheap as well. I'm pretty sure you only have to pay like 20 cents for each model. So yeah, if you did ever want to get into 3D scanning for your showcases, I 100% recommend it. It's what I do now. And it saves so much time having to make every single model from scratch, which I have done before. However, the option that I use is quite different. So those museums that I credited in my game, how exactly did I get the models if I didn't go to them in person? Well, you might remember a little while ago when Notre Dame set on fire, so much of that valuable architecture was gone, and it made people realize that everything that we have on this world is temporary. As you can see here, a team of people have been working on recreating Notre Dame in a 3D space to preserve it forever. And while digital preservation of ancient artifacts has been around for a while, it really got popular when the Notre Dame set on fire, and lots of museums all around the world have been working towards preserving their artifacts digitally by 3D scanning them and uploading them to sites. One of them is Sketchfab. If you're a Roblox builder that doesn't know about Sketchfab, you are missing out. I specifically use museum artifacts for two reasons. The first is that they fit with my theme. The other thing is that museum artifacts are usually royalty-free, considering the people that originally made them are very dead, and because museums love to educate and expose all of this ancient history to a wide audience, they are more than happy for you to use their assets. The virtual museums of Malpolska, for example, upload so many 3D scans of all of their museum artifacts, and you can easily download them, and as you can see here, commercial use is completely fine. That means that you can make money off of it as long as you credit the author, which I do in my game. So if you want to go about making 3D models using museum artifacts, how about I show you how? For free! Right now. So here is an absolutely beautiful piece of pottery uploaded by the Hunt Museum in Ireland. This would look absolutely beautiful in a garden showcase such as Renave. However, as you can see here, it is 500,000 triangles. If you want to import a model into Roblox, it has to be at a maximum 10,000 triangles, and that's still a lot. We can definitely optimize this, and I'm going to teach you how to do that using Blender. So first we're going to download it. Always make sure that you're allowed to use it first. Commercial use is allowed as long as the author is credited. I always recommend to download the file in its original format. This one is OBJ. Here it is in my downloads. I'm going to extract it because it's a zip folder, and then you're left with two folders. One contains the textures. Let's extract the source. The source will contain the 3D model itself. Here it is. In Blender, I'm going to get rid of all of this stuff, and I'm going to import the OBJ. And here it is. It's very big. Let's scale it down a little bit. And it doesn't have its textures, but don't worry, we will deal with that. So what I'm going to teach you to do is reduce the triangles of this model, and I'm also going to teach you how to make a texture and a normal map for it. So firstly, we're going to duplicate this model by pressing Shift D, and this one is going to be the high poly version, and this one is going to be the low poly version. Let's make the high poly version invisible for now. I'm going to put on the statistics so I can see exactly how many triangles there are, 509,000. I'm also going to quickly shade smooth to flat. There are two ways you could go about reducing the polygons of this mesh. The first way is to completely remodel it from scratch, but that takes lots of time, and considering I want to do this 9,000 times with lots of different objects, I'm going to do the quick and easy way, which is to add a decimate modifier. Let's reduce it down to 0.1, and as you can see, the model has magically gone down from 500,000 to 50,000 triangles, and it looks pretty much the same. However, Roblox is still not going to take this. We need to get it down to 10,000. Let's move this all the way down until it says 10,000 triangles. So here it is at 10,000. Still not looking too bad. However, we can definitely measure this further. I like to play around with a slider, and I will reduce its triangles until I can see that the form of the mesh is starting to go funny. So about here. We have now reduced this model to 760 triangles. That is huge compared to the 500,000 that we started with. And as you can see, it looks pretty lame compared to what it used to be. However, we can fix this still. We're going to click Shade Smooth, and then we're going to start baking. Before I do that, I want to edit the UV map. Click A, and this is the current UV map. If you don't know, the UV map is essentially visualizing what the texture looks like in a 2D space. Think of a cardboard box that you unwrap and flatten. That's what this is. I'm going to make a new map. I'm just going to smart UV project it. New smart UV project. Okay, so this is our new UV map. Could definitely be polished. However, considering I'm doing this 9,000 times, this is fine. So over to shading. Firstly, what we want to do is add the texture map to the original. We downloaded it along with the model. Shift A, image texture, and we're going to connect that up to the base color. Open our texture. This is the original model with its texture now. It doesn't really work on the low poly version. And so what we're actually going to do is make a new texture for it. We're going to bake normal maps and its texture map. Shift A, image texture, connect that up, and we're going to create a new image texture. I'm just going to call it C for color, and we're also going to create a normal texture as well. So image texture, connect that up to the normal, and we're going to put N for normal. We're also going to add a normal map. And now we're ready to bake. So I'm gonna start with the normal map. Make sure that the normal map is selected. Select your high poly model and then shift select your low poly model so that they're both selected. And to bake, we go to render. We're going to change our render engine to cycles and we are going to bake it and change that to normal. Select it to active and let's do an extrusion of 0.1 and we click bake and we wait. And here is our normal map, and as you can see, it's not looking very pretty. All of these yellows and greens and reds, we don't want these. This means that I haven't made the extrusion high enough. Let's try 5. Oh yeah, I think that's the one. So let's save this image, and then it's time to do the color. Make sure you've got your color image selected, and then change your normal map to diffuse, and uncheck direct and indirect. We only want to be baking color. It'll remember the extrusion that we picked, and so just click bake. And if you look at our model, that looks pretty good. So let's save this, and then let's also export this model as well. I'm going to export it as an FBX, because I prefer FBX over OBJ, but if you want to do OBJ, that's fine too. We want to export the selected object only. Let's get this into Roblox Studio. So let's insert a mesh part by right-clicking insert object mesh part, and in the mesh ID, let's import our model. It's very large, so let's resize it. Let's not worry about location data. It's just going to be here. And there it is! Woohoo! Look, it even remembered the color map. So that is your 3D model. However, we can make this look even better. I'm actually going to get rid of this color map. Right click, insert object, surface appearance. As you can see, we can play around with its color map, its metal mass, its normal map, and its roughness map. So let's go on to Roblox, creations, development items, decals, and let's upload those texture maps. In the images tab, let's get them up in separate tabs, and as you can see in the link, they have this little string of numbers. So we're going to copy this number for the color map, and we are going to paste it into the color map property here. We're also going to paste in the normal map as well, and you might notice that this model will look a little bit nicer now. It's really defined those edges. There's only one more thing we need to do, which is to make this model glossy. After all, this is a varnished pot, so I'm just going to search up black. It is a completely black image. Copy asset ID, and I'm going to paste it into the roughness map. As you can see, it is now very, very shiny. Congratulations, you have just successfully imported a museum artifact into Roblox Studio. Well done you. So if you're starting to wonder why exactly I haven't uploaded a showcase since January, it's because I have been doing this every day 9,000 times. Could you imagine how long it took if I made this model from scratch? This saves so much time and you get a pretty decent model out of it. In fact, let's see what it looks like in one of my showcases. So here we are in Renee, and let's see how the pot looks in here. Would you look at that one? If we put it inside this area, place it over here. Oh yeah. And also, if you decide that you don't like the color, you can actually mess around with the color inside of the surface appearance. Let's make it a little bit more yellow. I think that that works much better. And so as you can see, this bicycle, these pots, this table, this pottery, all of these are 3D models that I optimized in Blender using the technique that I showed you. It takes a very long time. However, modeling them from scratch takes even longer. It saves so much time and it makes your showcase look good, and you're not stealing from anyone either. So yeah, if you ever want to consider doing this, I 100% recommend it. Using models from Sketchfab and optimizing them in Blender can be very janky, especially if you're a new user, and so I strongly recommend that you join my Discord server. You are welcome to ping me and ask me questions. If you have any issues or need any help, I'm always willing to talk you through it. I don't really know how to end this video. Bye.